Hey there, how's it going everybody? Dan here with PlantAbundance.com. So we had a really good rain event come into the Bay Area, and I'm happy to report that my rain barrel system is completely topped off now. It was a quarter full before the rain poured in. And I'll just give you a peek here. So this is at maximum capacity. Anything over this level goes out through the overflow. And because this entire rain barrel system is on an interconnected manifold system, all of these barrels are always balanced, whether it's filling up or draining, which is nice. It keeps all the weight evenly distributed, so you're not going to get any heavy spots on your platform if you've got your barrels raised up a bit for the extra gravity feed that you obtain from that. So I've got 12 barrels total. Each one of these is holding about 35 gallons. So we got a total capacity of 420 gallons here. As you can see, we got really good water pressure. This is why I recommend using a 3/4 inch ball valve over your standard water spigot, which is going to reduce and restrict your water flow. Also, you can see my first flush diverter green waste bin here is completely topped off. This actually holds 96 gallons, believe it or not. So adding that with what I got in the barrels, I've got about 515 gallons here. You know, my favorite way to use this rainwater is to water my seedlings and transplants as they're growing. And also, I love using rainwater for my compost tea. So besides that, I've been staying really busy even with the rain. One thing I like to do shortly after a rain is to actually get my weeding done. And you know, generally speaking, I don't have too much weeding to do because of the fact that not only do I heavily mulch with wood chips, but before I had started that whole process, I did a nice layering of cardboard throughout the entire landscape everywhere I have wood chips. And that really pretty much stopped all the weed growth, but they still pop up here and there. This area right here, I've got a lot of Bermuda grass that crawls under the fence from the neighbor's yard, unfortunately, but I wanted to show you this tool as it's quickly become one of my favorite gardening tools to have. This is a Japanese tool called a Hori Hori, which stands for Dig Dig, and now that I've got one of these, I couldn't do without it. It's a really great tool to have. It's so much stronger than a garden trowel, you know, a small hand shovel. Yeah, this is stainless steel. It's very sharp and durable. It's got a nice tough serrated edge on it. It's got a really nice rosewood handle. Just feels good in the hand. This thing is just so durable and tough. You could use this not just for weeding. You could use it as a digging tool. You could use it to slice open bags of compost. You can cut through roots, bushes, branches, grass, all sorts of things with it. It also comes with a nice heavy-duty nylon holster, so I can keep it next to me on my hip as I'm out there in the garden. Let me show you how great this thing works for pulling out weeds. As you know, with many weeds with deeper tap roots, you don't want to snap that root off below the surface or the weed's just going to come back. So this tool allows you to get really deep down and really just pop those roots all the way up and loosen up the soil down below. That way you can get the entire taproot out and the weed's not going to come back. Here's another example of this. So I've got several different types of weeds popping up here and there. Here is some oxalis. It spreads underground through its roots. It also spreads from the seeds that the flower produces, so it's really important to take control of this before it gets too out of hand. So throughout today, I actually filled up an entire wheelbarrow with different types of weeds, Bermuda grass, all sorts of things, and the Hori Hori made quick work of it. So besides that, I've been prepping some new garden beds. I'm always just doing tasks here and there. Here's some thyme that's growing at the base of a fruit tree. And thyme is a really great herb to grow around the base of fruit trees. It's a perennial. Obviously, you can use it in your culinary dishes. It's just a great aromatic herb to have around. And it transplants very easily. So I just took a little clump out and transplanted this to my hugel culture mound right at the end here at the base of this 3-year-old moringa tree. This will be sprouting out as soon as the weather heats up a bit. And this thyme should not only create a living mulch around that moringa, but it might even cascade a bit over the edge of the log on this hugel culture. I also sprouted a whole bunch of new moringa seeds. So if you're not familiar, check out my other video on the moringa oleifera. This is just a very powerful plant to have in the landscape. And I can vouch for the fact that if you're in zone 9B, it's going to come back as a perennial. It'll die back in the winter, but it'll come back each year, stronger and better. And in colder areas, you can grow this as an annual. You could keep it potted up. You can even bring them into your greenhouse in the wintertime and keep them viable. So the way I sprouted these seeds is I just put all my seeds on a couple plates in between some damp paper towels. Then I set those on a heating mat to help expedite the sprouting process. And after just about 10 days, I've got a whole bunch of seeds now that have sprouted and they're ready to go now. Now, because time is of the essence with these young Moringa seedlings, I'm going to be transplanting them into these 16-ounce party cups. And this isn't really the most ideal situation. The Moringa has a deep tap root. It's very fragile. So you really want to have an elongated pot to plant these in if you're going to be putting them in a pot rather than directly in the ground. I actually did plant a few of these directly into the landscape. But besides putting these in the landscape, I'm also going to try to propagate some of these and have some extras to share or trade with other gardeners in my local area. I'm not going to allow these to grow very long in these cups. I'm going to transplant them to deeper pots or out into the landscape before that taproot hits the bottom. And the general rule of thumb with the Moringa is however tall the growth is above the soil surface, you can assume that the taproot is going to be twice that length below. So by the time this plant is just 3 inches tall, I'm going to want to have this transplanted to a deeper pot. So I went ahead and brought all these in under the grow lights into a warmer climate. See if I can get these growing quicker than just leaving them outside. It's still a bit chilly outside. But here's how I planted out a few of the seedlings. These are some cardboard planters that I made up. I was able to pick up a whole bunch of these 5-inch cardboard tubes from a local business person. So we got an arrangement as long as I need them. And I cut these down to about 1.5 feet each. Then I just lined the bottom of this Rubbermaid container with some soil to help give these planters a bottom. And 7 tubes fit into one of these Rubbermaids nice and snug. Just filled that up with some organic potting soil. And I plan on having several tubs set up like this. So that's what I've been up to. Hope you all enjoyed the video, and as always, I hope this video finds you and finds you well, out in the world and out in your garden, planting more abundance in your life. Take care, everybody. I'll be talking to you again soon.